I wanted to start off by saying that I first saw Lisa at an AOPO conference right before the pandemic started. And after I heard her speak, I ran into the lobby to try to grab her. And I said, oh, please, would you please consider coming on our podcast? We do this, the Gifted Life podcast. And she graciously accepted. And we had a wonderful conversation with her a couple of years ago, episode 134, if you want to check it out. And then earlier this year, she was letting everybody know that she had started another project. And I'm sorry, I need to back up and tell you that when Lisa first spoke, she was telling us about this wonderful, her story, but also this wonderful book she wrote called Big Shoes. And I encourage everybody to grab a copy of this. But after that, she went on another endeavor and wrote a song in honor of her husband called This Beautiful Life, and did just an incredible video that featured lots of donor families and recipients from around the US, maybe around the world, I'm not sure. And when we started talking, I was so inspired. I said, you know, there's so many things I'd love to do with you. One, please come back on the podcast, which she did. And we just released that episode a couple weeks ago. And then I said, you know, I really feel like our volunteer group would benefit tremendously from hearing from you. And part of the reason is Lisa wrote one of the most beautiful quotes that I think just kind of sums up all of the donation and transplantation process. And I don't want to get it wrong, so I'm going to read it really quick. Organ donation is like life. It's about the trying. And when someone gives the gift of donation, they are giving another family a chance to try. And sometimes it is all we get, and somehow it's enough. So there are many things that I think Lisa could share with us, but in our recent conversations, we talked about her focus on empathy. And so I believe that's gonna be the focus of her talk today. And maybe we'll be able to talk her into coming back to touch on some of the other subjects we think she'd be wonderful as a leader for us. So Lisa Bradshaw.
Well, thank you so much for that introduction. I'm going to grab tissue because you've already got me a little choked up, so I'll have it here if I need it. I'm going to play the song at the end. If y'all stick around, I'll play it for you with the video. I don't know if you can see me, so I'm just going to start my screen here. You can see me? Okay. So thank you for having me. I just want to start by saying that I see that there are some donor recipients, some donor families, and people who work in the ever-challenging yet beautiful business of organ donation and awareness. So I'm just always grateful to be here. I'll share with you that right before the pandemic, I was giving the talk at that Garrison talked about in San Diego. And then the pandemic happened, and I thought, you know, I'm kind of think I might tap out here and go live. I'm trying to find my share screen options. It's only showing me your screen here. One second, sorry.
Present now down at the bottom right.
Yeah, I hit that. Oh, a window. Here it is. Here we go, folks. So what I wanted to say is that I kind of thought, well, maybe I won't do this work anymore. It's heartbreaking sometimes. And sometimes I feel like I need to move on in my life and start a different story that doesn't include the heartache of losing Wesley. But then I talked to Kirsten a couple months ago, and she just re-inspired me so much so that I'll share with you a bit at the end of something new I'm working on. So I just appreciate all of your support, and let me know. You can see the screen now?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. So I'm going to start. I think what I want to share with you today is a lot of what I shared that Kirsten heard, but with a different angle to it. So let me just get started where my story starts. So this is Dr. McCabe, my family doctor, who delivered me, almost 50 years ago. And he was my first introduction to healthcare and the expectations of a patient and a provider. And he just really, he's been a special person in our family. He is, this is him. He's 85 years old now.
And when I got in advance.
What's that?
The slide didn't advance to
Dr. It didn't.
It's no, not it's advanced. On yours.
Oh goodness, hold on. I might have to go with that other.
Don't know why. There you go. That worked.
Oh, it's, oh, so does it just show Dr. McCabe?
Yep.
It doesn't show my whole screen.
It shows a little bit on the sides.
Interesting. All right, well, we're going to go with this, guys.
Let me try. We can see him in the center, big.
Okay, let's do that. One second, I'm just going to fix, let's see if I can get rid of the stuff on the side. How's that? Is that better?
It's about the same, but I think it works.
Okay.
Perfect.
All right. So I'm going to start again here. Dr. McKay was my family doctor, and he delivered me 50 years ago, almost 50 years ago, it'll be 50 in September. And like I said, he just started teaching me about the importance of communication and relationship with your provider and the patient. And he was also often ran late. And to the point that my grandma discontinued her care with him. But I never minded him running late because I always felt like I received excellent care when it was my turn. And I knew he was giving excellent care to everyone else as well. This picture is actually a picture his wife took of him. We got back in touch when I was getting ready to give the talk in San Diego for AOPO. And I asked his wife if I could get a picture of him. And it was funny because they have no idea how to use text messaging or anything. But isn't it sweet that my doctor sat there and took a picture for me for this talk and gave me permission? So this is Dr. McCabe. He is the beginning of my story. I will also say, can you see me there?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. So this is about 8 years old, and I was living on a dead-end street, no fancy cul-de-sac, and I remember climbing to the top of a tree when I was 8 years old, and all the kids in the neighborhood were gone off playing or somewhere else, and I remember just being bored and quiet and curious, and I also remember getting the sense that there was more to life than what I was learning just on that one street. I'd started following my neighbors to church. I was curious about God. I was curious about my purpose. And it's also the age that I started thinking about, you know, what is my life supposed to become? At 8 years old, I don't know why I was thinking these things, but I was. And I remember being told in that tree that my life would be arduous, but it would be equally rewarding. And I would have no idea what that meant until much later. 8 years old is also about the age I got this typewriter, one looking just like it. And it was very, it was a pivotal time in my life because I was very interested in learning to write and I was too much of a perfectionist. So if I wrote in my journal and made a mistake, I wanted to cross it off or rip out the page and start over. So what I loved about this typewriter gifted to me from my parents for Christmas was that it had corrective ribbon. And there's nothing I loved more than being able to fix my story and keep writing. This is also about the age that I met, goodness, I wish it would come later, but I went to the movie and saw the movie Rocky. And I don't know how many of you have seen the movie Rocky or how many of you apply it to your own life, but it changed the way I thought about storytelling. And I learned even more once the second film was released, because they talked in such detail about the success of the first film and how Sylvester Stallone had lived in an apartment that was super, super small and not very nice in a pretty sketchy part of Hollywood. And he was just carving it out and working so hard on writing this script. He had $106 to his name. He'd sold his dog. And when it came time to sell this script, they offered him what would have been enough money for some people, but they didn't want him to act in the story. And so he never gave up, over $300,000 they were offering him at one point. And then finally they agreed to let him tell the story and be in the movie. And that was my first lesson in perseverance and understanding what a person's willing to go through to help tell a story. And this is also the age that I met Wesley. And those are our school pictures from the year that we met. I was 8 and he was 10 years old. And my mom is still angry with me to this day, and I'm pretty angry with myself because I used to get into her photo albums and mess with her pictures, and even sent some to Wesley later in life that he lost. So somewhere there are pictures of us as kids, but this is the best I could do, and it shows the age that we met. So it starts our story. But I remember seeing him for the first time, and he was playing football with my brother and his friends in the front yard. And I walked out onto the front porch, and I looked at him and he looked at me, and somehow I just knew that he would be important to my life. I don't think he felt the same way at all, but I was pretty sure about how I felt. I just couldn't have known that we would eventually fall in love. This is, he was 17, just turned 18 on this week, and I was 15. And I hadn't seen him in 5 years. And we saw each other again when he was on leave from the Navy, and I went to visit his family in Texas. I also couldn't have known that I would grow up and marry him, and that we would be able to gather in front of our families and friends. And I'll say that when I was about 20 years old, I only told my sister, I got on a plane and went to visit him when he got out of the Navy. And I told her if he didn't fall in love with me in a weekend, I'd forget about him. And I got there on Friday, and I'm pretty sure we were in love by Sunday and got married about 2 years later. So couldn't have known any of those things. Most definitely couldn't have known that I would be diagnosed with cancer just around 2 years after we got married. And, you know, it was a really difficult time. I remember feeling I had Hodgkin's disease. I was told how treatable it was. But I also felt like, you know, it felt very sad to me that at 24 years old, the best that I could hope for was one of the better kinds of cancer. And I struggled with that on many levels for a long time. I feared cancer. I feared recurrence. I checked for lumps. It took me a long time to get through that fear of recurrence and just how will I live the rest of my life and not feel that fear. And then we got pregnant with Hunter, our son, despite the risk of infertility that we faced, and that we just couldn't have known what joy he would bring to our lives or the things that we would learn from being parents. I was very fortunate. I got to stay home with him, and I would most definitely spend kind of every day of our lives together just waking up and wondering what I could teach him and what he could teach me. And it's just been the honor of my lifetime to be his mother. So what I will say too is that we weren't in any hurry to have more children yet. We figured we'd wait till Hunter was about 4 years old, and then we'd try again to have another baby. And the week that Hunter turned 4 years old, his dad was cleaning out an old cabinet in our garage, and it had mold and droppings and a bag of fertilizer that was soaking wet and should have been dry. And Wesley came inside for whatever reason. Hunter was inside the house with me. He usually would have been outside, you know, helping his dad. And Hunter was in his bedroom playing. He was a week away from turning 4 years old. And Wesley said he was short of breath, and he wanted Hunter and I to stay inside. He was going to close up the cabinet, but he didn't feel well. So we stayed inside, and by the end of the evening, Wesley felt worse and worse until eventually he saw a doctor who tried a few different things like an inhaler and giving it time. But ultimately, Wesley received a lung biopsy and was hospitalized multiple times. And then exactly 1 year to the day of him cleaning the garage, he received a double lung transplant. And when I went through cancer, I really felt betrayed by my body, and I really struggled. And then when I got pregnant with Hunter, I remember the moment I found out I was pregnant and just feeling like the same body that had created cancer had healed and created a human life. And I thought about the times that when I was told, the time that I was told in the tree that my life would be arduous and equally rewarding. And so when I was sick, I wrote a book based on the journal I kept during that time. And I thought, well, I've helped people with my story. I've survived. I've had a baby. We've had this child together. So nothing really bad came from it. But my whole life up to that point was about finding the balance. I had cancer. How can I help people? How can I make sure I survive and live a long and full life? And when Wesley got sick, I was a really high functioning griever. I was able to raise our son and have a career and figured out a way to feed my kid and feed my soul and be home by the time he got home from school every day at 3 o'clock. I hadn't forgotten about the tree. I hadn't forgotten that there would be arduous times, but equally rewarding. So I was constantly in search of the balance, constantly in search of the reward. And in the years ahead, after Wesley died, so much of our lives and my purpose became about filling the gaping hole in our lives, knowing now that I was the mother of our fatherless son. And that to me felt very off from any balance that I could muster through our experience, because I had cancer, I survived, I got better. Wesley never got better. He was never getting better. And I saw someone join us earlier who mentioned that they're a lung transplant recipient. And that person and very, you know, other people who've experienced it, when I had cancer and I felt good on a day, I could go for a walk and I could, you know, visit people and feel a bit normal. But Wesley never felt normal. He never could go on a walk. It was very difficult for him to even go from the couch to the kitchen. And he's the one who cooked. So it was very difficult for all of us. Our lives were turned upside down for Hunter, Wesley, and me. But I just kept trying to find a way to make sense of it and make sure that he had a fighting chance like I did. And that began with Dr. Patel. She is a doctor in Houston. I want to show you this next part. She's also on a billboard. So if you're going to have a doctor, you want her to be such a renowned physician that she ends up on a billboard at some point. But that's her, Dr. Patel. And every slide you see in this presentation that gives the name of the physician, they have allowed me to use it with permission. We were struggling with his diagnosis, which was basically for him to go home on oxygen and keep an eye on things. There wasn't really a diagnosis, I should say, but with what care we were being offered. And our neighbor worked in the UT health system in Texas, in Houston, and she knew of Dr. Patel, and she got us in to see Dr. Patel. And she was our beginning of hope, because her theory about what happened to Wesley gave us hope, because perhaps he showered clots while in the hospital, perhaps this, perhaps that. But she gave him some steroids and he stayed on oxygen and he had a little brief improvement. And we were thinking this was our hope, and she was our hope. And during this time when Wesley was first sick, he was Wesley, or Hunter's Little League coach. He was so excited about being a coach. I remember he knew that there were two boys on the team that really couldn't afford the uniform through the Y, and the YMCA didn't buy the pants. So Wesley, instead of buying pants for two children and making them feel like, you know, bringing attention to it, he went ahead and just bought pants for the whole team. And he was just so excited to coach Hunter in baseball. And this is Hunter getting his trophy at the end of the season. And you can see that Wesley's wearing oxygen. And we tried really hard to have normal lives during this time. You know, we would carry, Wesley was so oxygen deprived that he at first refused a wheelchair, but eventually conceded to it. And we would put Hunter in his lap, and then there'd be a tank on each step of the wheelchair, and then a tank on the in the spot where they actually let you hold the tank. There's a mechanism for it. And then we bought a bag, like a Nike duffel bag, that allowed for two more tanks. And that's what we needed to go to the mall or to go somewhere when Wesley eventually agreed, or to go to the zoo or do some of the things we used to do, because we just couldn't bear to run out, obviously. And I remember this one particular time, Wesley could no longer go to the baseball games. The wheelchair wouldn't push across the grass, and it was too far for him to walk. And he was just destroyed by it. And I remember one morning getting Hunter ready for his game, and Wesley was the first one he was going to miss. And I put Hunter in the car, and I came back inside to get something, and Wesley was standing by the window just crying. And I went to talk to him to try to soothe him, and he just put his hand up to me from across the room, telling me basically, just go and leave him to this moment. And that's what I did. There were no words I could offer him. And so in our effort to try to have normal lives, there was a one particular day that we'd planned to take Hunter to downtown Houston because they were going to have fake snow. And Wesley was a guy who always had plans for us for our weekends. And some of my friends would even come up with us with their kids if their husbands were kind of at home sitting on the couch. And so I went ahead and took Hunter to this downtown venue. And Wesley was in the hospital at this point for a minor complication. He had a bit of an infection in the stitches where his Portocath was placed for his Flolan drug. And the Flolan drug, we had to be trained on how to use it, how to administer it, had to be given at the same time every day. It had to stay cold. It had to have a battery pack on the device where it was stored. It was so much commitment. And so it was also very dangerous if he got an infection. So we went ahead. Dr. Patel was out of town. She went ahead and admitted him. It was the first time he was admitted without a without being admitted to the ICU. And we just were pretty sure that he had some redness from the stitches. And so they were going to watch it. And this was a Saturday that he was admitted. So he's in a regular room, which was nice because, you know, he meant he didn't need a lot of care, but it also meant he didn't have a lot of supervision. And so what ended up happening was, in comes Dr. Florida. And if you see a name here with quotes, that means they don't have my permission and they probably wouldn't want to be in this slideshow. So this is just a stock photo to represent Dr. Florida. I call him Dr. Florida because he went to Florida State. He was a Gator, and he and Wesley would joke back and forth because we're Texas A&M Aggies. So I just started calling him Dr. Florida, and he thought it was funny, and I meant no disrespect. So Dr. Florida was a resident, and he wasn't familiar with Flolan, but he was there for the weekend. Dr. Patel, as I said, was out of town. And I'm not sure where his attending was because I hadn't met the attending. And I went ahead and was reluctant, but I said, okay, I'm going to just leave for a little while and take my son down to the convention center, which wasn't far from the hospital. And he said, you know, just go ahead and go. Call me if you have questions. So I got this really icky feeling. My mom was there with us. And I just thought, something doesn't feel right to me. I just feel like this doctor really doesn't understand. We need to get an answer from the radiology team. Are we going to move this portacath, or what are we going to do? Because you can't take the Flolan out. It cannot stop. If it stops for more than 2 minutes, Wesley could die. And so I called because I had this gut feeling, and I talked to Dr. Florida, and he said to me, I tell you what, how about we do this? How about you know, we'll go ahead, I'll put in an order to stop the Flolan, and that'll give us a chance to hear back from the radiology team. They're gone for the weekend. They haven't answered my page. And then, you know, come Monday, everyone will be here and Dr. Patel will be here. We can all make a decision together. And I was just so dumbfounded. And I said, I'll tell you what, hang up the phone, find your attending, tell him what you told me. Don't touch my husband. I will be there in 20 minutes. And he kind of stuttered and stammered, like didn't know what to say. And I just hung up and said, don't touch my husband. So I get there and, well, first of all, Wesley calls me on my way there and he's mad at me. And keep in mind, he's on 80 to 100 milligrams of steroids at this point. So he was mad at me most of the time. And he said to me, what have you done? You know, what's going on? They said you're on your way and you're furious. And there's three doctors outside my door. And I very rarely fought back with him because I didn't want to make it harder for him. But I did say to him, because he was asleep when they came in. And I said, if I hadn't done what I did, you would have been asleep. They would have stopped your Flolan and I would have come back and you'd have been dead. And then he was mad at Dr. Florida. So I showed up and the attending Dr. Florida and another physician were in the hallway when I got there, and the attending apologized. So they did an emergent page for radiology to come and move the portacath and everything would be taken care of. And I remember seeing Dr. Florida in the hallway and just thinking this is an opportunity for him to understand the plight of a patient and caregiver. I couldn't leave the hospital for 2 hours, 10 minutes away without the risk of something happening. And Wesley was so sick that there wasn't far to go. I mean, aside from Flolan and how critical it was that he received this constant infusion, there were other things that could have happened to him at any point. And so Dr. Florida and I had a chat in the hallway and I just told him, I'm one of 1,000 wives that you'll meet in your career and you can never forget this day. You can never forget this day because you can't make mistakes like this. It's hard enough for me to keep Wesley alive without somebody making a mistake. And I bet he remembers us. I hope he remembers us. But we just kept on going. This is Wesley painting Hunter. And in the background is our desk, which is a total disaster. Our house was just a mess for a year, but that's the way it goes. So we just tried to keep going. And Wesley did his best. I remember him keeping a chart about how he felt and then realizing he wasn't getting any better. And he put the chart away. And I remember us having to battle with the insurance company, because back then to have a pulse ox machine, you had to bring a whole machine literally home, and the insurance wouldn't provide it. So I remember going to battle with them saying, you know, if we knew his oxygen was being depleted, we could get help before he's in a state where he needs the ICU. It would save you money. I finally got them to agree. Of course, now they have the little thing you can take home on your finger that's you could fit in your pocket, but they didn't have that then. So I just tried to do the best I could to make sure that I was looking out for my boys and making sure that I was not only Wesley's nurse, but Hunter's mother and Wesley's wife. And it was very hard to be all things to all people. And our number one priority was Hunter. And honestly, Hunter and then Wesley's health. But that didn't make sense to me, because if we were thinking about Hunter, we needed to try to keep Wesley alive. And that's what we were always trying to do. And I remember watching an episode of ER, the show with from years ago. And Wesley had been complaining to me for a day or so about his vision. And he said, when I look at you, you're blurry, but everything behind you is clear. And I don't know why, and I don't know how to describe it. And I said, well, let's just keep an eye on it. And if you don't notice an improvement by tomorrow or something, or the next day, I'll get a hold of Dr. Patel. And of course, by now, Wesley's been hospitalized multiple times and Dr. Patel is in my cell phone and we can reach her anytime and she is available to us. It's probably why she's on that billboard, because she takes good care of her patients, as well as she's one of the most capable women I've ever met. So I'm watching ER and I recorded it back on VHS back then. And I recorded because sometimes things would come up, or I had to mix Wesley's medicine every night at 9 p.m., which is when the show was on. And so I would record it and just try to watch it later. And I was watching it one night, and Bob Newhart was guest starring, and he was someone being admitted because he had a heart condition, and he was on a medication called Digoxin, and Wesley was on that medication. And then during the episode, they showed him looking at his doctor, and they showed his point of view. So I went and got Wesley, and I said, come watch this, come look at this. And I had recorded it so I could pause and show it to him. And I said, is this what you see? And it showed Bob Newhart looking at his doctor, and the doctor was blurry, but everything outside of him, her, was clear. And he said, that's exactly what I see. And I said, well, he has too much Digoxin. He's has an overdose, and they have to reduce his medication. So you're on Digoxin. Maybe that's what's wrong. So I text Dr. Patel, and she said, I'll order labs for him in the morning. And sure enough, Wesley had too much Digoxin on board, and all he needed was to reduce his dose, and he was good as new. And I like to laugh about it because I was just watching ER for this guy, George Clooney. But it's just part of life. When you're going through a crisis, you got to try to learn wherever you can and apply what you learn. That's the most important part, is to apply what we learn. And so through this whole experience, you know, I say that we're trying to save Wesley's life, but at this point, transplant still seemed far off, and it seemed really, really scary. But yet it seemed also to give us hope. And I don't really know. I mean, it's a long and complicated story how we got to transplant and the moment that we were told, and how we navigated that. But really, I read something that Wesley wrote recently, and he said how we just had to cowboy up, and we had to accept that this is the hand we were dealt, and we don't think about how hard it is. We just do it, and we're just taking care of each other and doing the best we could. And so right away, when we found out about the transplant, you know, I think about when Wesley first got sick, and I called my dad in the middle of the night, and I was saying to him, when he was in the hospital the very first time for that shortness of breath and an open lung biopsy, and I said to my dad, I was 1 a.m, and I hadn't seen Hunter since I dropped since I took Wesley to the hospital, because Hunter was in bed when I got home. My mom was visiting, and I kind of planned it that way. I didn't know how to face Hunter. And I said to my dad during that conversation, I said, you know, Wesley isn't going to grow old with me, is he? We're not going to grow old together. And my dad is a silver lining, glass half full guy. So when he said to me, you're probably right, so, but Wesley can have enough years with you to prepare you for a life without him, I was devastated yet comforted by his truth. And when we made the decision to have the transplant, it was kind of like that call to my dad. It was the, you know, this would give us a chance. My dad was right. This would give us a chance for as many years as Wesley could spend with us to help prepare us for a life if he didn't survive. Wesley had a rare blood type. He immediately started doing research. And he found out that the University of Alabama had no wait list for his blood type. So that was 10 hours from home. And that's where we decided to go. We relocated. We went through all the evaluations for testing. Many of you know what that's all about. And during that process, we were living in a hotel, and we were very having a very hard time navigating this, and just wanting for the testing to go faster and something to happen. And so I remember calling a woman named, I'll call her Emma, and she was the person arranging all of our appointments. And she said, I said, can you do anything? Can we just get some blood work, something scheduled? Because, you know, it's this process is taking so long, and we're really struggling here. And so she said she would try. I didn't hear from her for a couple of days, so I figured she just kind of forgot about us. But she called me back 2 days later, and she'd moved every single appointment up by at least a week or two. And so with her help, and because of what she did, we were able to get further along in the testing process. And this is when we met Dr. Young, and he was the head of pulmonary transplant then. And I'll tell you this, every appointment, it seemed appropriate, we took Hunter with us because I wanted them to know who they were fighting for. And when we talk about empathy and we talk about providers, you know, I'd like to think that the fact that I put up finger paintings of Hunter made for his dad or pictures, and that I was always there, that Wesley didn't get any better care because of it. But it's because of that care that I am in touch with Dr. Patel. I have permission from Dr. Young. Everyone that you're meeting through this presentation who's real and gave permission is still in my cell phone. They're still a part of my life if I would ever need them. And in the lives of the people that I've tried to help because they've given their permission, they've given their endorsement. And it was this man who empathized with our plight, saw the need for a try, didn't know if Wesley could even survive the surgery, but he survived the walk that he was required to do and all the other hoops that you must jump through. And Wesley was listed. And so because Emma did what she did and got the appointments moved up, Wesley was listed on a Wednesday. We got a call on Friday night of that 2 days later, and he was transplanted on Saturday morning. And we would have missed those lungs and that opportunity and that gift from the family of strangers if he'd not been listed when he was. And then, you know, this is Trina. I can't not mention our transplant coordinator, who was the one that called us. You know, the call when they say, just get some sleep and show up in 6 hours as if you're going to sleep for even a minute. And here's a little video of Hunter after his dad got his transplant. Keeping in mind that up to this point, Wesley was still on a lot of steroids and not too happy about things.
Okay, I'm videoing you right now. So you just got to see your dad. What do you think of that?
Cool.
Was it cool?
Yes.
What did you just tell me about him being happy?
Maybe because he's not arguing.
No, but what did you say about him looking happy? He doesn't have that medicine anymore.
Because he's not angry.
Yeah, he looks happy, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. His new lungs made him happy. Made me happy, too. Mm-hmm. And you?
Yep.
So, now we're going to go to the airport and get our friends.
Yes. Never get my buddy.
Well, that kid, you know what? He graduates from college on Mother's Day in just 2 weeks. Hard to believe. You know, Wesley did have a breakthrough, not a breakdown, but he did have a breakthrough about 3 weeks before his transplant when he started realizing that he couldn't take every single thing out on us. And he better spend the last days or weeks or years loving on his family and accepting his plight and fighting as hard as he could against how the steroids made him feel. And he did that. He definitely did that. So the thing that I want to share is just there were times in our care, in Wesley's care, that no one could have known what our day was like. No one could have known what any moment was like. Wesley received his transplant. He coded during surgery. He coded 18 times over the next 6 weeks. And it seemed that every time I left the hospital, even for a half a day to spend with Hunter, and we had family flying in and out trying to help us, and Hunter was just used to Wesley and me and my parents. He didn't spend time with anyone else except maybe my best friend. So this was a big adjustment for all of us. But I remember one time getting a call about a code, and I got the call from Dr. Willie. And Dr. Willie, he is on the board of the Don't Wait Project, the nonprofit I founded. I have visited him twice since Wesley's death. And he is one of the most compassionate physicians I've ever known. And I remember him, the nurse, calling me and saying I needed to get there because Wesley had coded and wasn't going to make it. And I was in a car with my sister and I had OnStar. So I pushed the button and I'm driving as fast as I can to get there. And a long story short, I had a police escort get me there. That's what I used OnStar for, but they took me to the wrong area of the hospital. So I threw it in park and I ran 3 blocks down the street. My sister had to find the hospital and get the car out of the middle of the street. I mean, it was just this moment, like, how do I get there in time? And then I'm running across the hall and I'm going up the elevator and running across another hall, getting there to just not even know if Wesley's alive. And thankfully that time he was. But did anyone know what I went through to get there, or what Wesley's mom was going there, sitting there on the floor waiting for me when I got there outside of the elevator? So that is why, like, we cannot assume anything as patients, as providers, as caregivers about anyone's life, especially these days, right? Everyone's so easy to attack and provide opinions, but we don't know the plight of others. We don't know what someone's gone through. Maybe they've run 3 blocks, you know, with their car parked in the street to try to get to their loved one in time. You just can't know. So Dr. Willie and doctors like him helped me find a balance between, you know, what I could expect from a provider and what I couldn't. And I'm just going to briefly touch on a few of them. Nurse David was a nurse who didn't believe in Wesley's survival. And I knew that because he told me. He said that Wesley's lungs were mush. He'd been on the vent too long and we'd need a new set of lungs, but his heart probably wouldn't make it. And he's a nurse. He wasn't his physician. I didn't ask his opinion, but I remember feeling like that maybe he wouldn't do that extra thing for Wesley. And then there was a code once, and I had tried to go see Wesley and they cleared the hall and said, you know, you can't come in during a code. So I knew that I wasn't calling to talk to nurse David. I was calling just for the person that was at the counter. And I just wanted to know, was it Wesley? And then she got David on the phone. And then when David came to the phone, I said, is it Wesley? And he said, I don't have time to talk to you. And I said, I didn't ask to talk to you. I was asking the person at the counter, but since you're, you know, like, I would never interrupt you. And he said, I can't talk to you right now. Well, it wasn't Wesley. But the time it took for him to go to the phone, to scold me for calling when I didn't even ask for him, to figure out that it wasn't Wesley an hour later, that's just not empathetic healthcare to me, you know? And I figured out that I could call David off of any future shifts for him. He could no longer take care of Wesley. And I got kind of called to the principal's office, I call it, by Dr. Young, who you saw before. And when I told him the story, he's all right, okay, that makes sense. That makes sense. And so I didn't have to feel bad about that. I mean, later on, there was a nurse, Lori, who was studying for her PA, and she would sign up for Wesley's shifts because at this point he was pretty much in a coma 24/7 and she could get her homework done. Well, there was one time I went to lunch. He was fine. I came back. He was sedated. He'd coded while I was at lunch. And when I say lunch, I mean grabbing a burger at the cafeteria for 5 minutes. So I went to her. I didn't go and call her off of a shift or anything. I went to her privately and I said, I understand that you think you can get a lot of work done while you're taking care of him. But the reason why you have to sit at his bedside is because there's a lot going on. And I'm just going to ask you to call yourself off and don't sign up for him for any future shifts. And she didn't. But I learned through the course of time that I can make these demands of people and that I have a right to do that. And if I don't feel like my loved one is getting the care they deserve, then something has to change. And I was the one in the position to change it. I wanted to show you when he was taking his breaths first time with the ventilator.
You like her okay, honey? So you're breathing on your own now.
He did good. He did good. You know, the thing that I really want to reiterate to each of you is that there are going to be people throughout our care, and unfortunately, each of us will, at some point, if we haven't already, experience some kind of medical crisis, either for ourselves or someone we love in our family. And we can hope to end up with an Emma, and we can hope to end up with a Dr. Patel or Dr. Willie, but there are gonna be Nurse Davids and Nurse Lori's. And there's gonna be Nurse Allison's. To this day, she is my friend. And she was the nurse that gave me hope, and she was the nurse that was with me the day that Wesley died. And when she came in and looked at me the way she did, I knew Wesley wasn't gonna make it out of that day, because every other time he'd had a crisis, she was there to reassure me that it wasn't over till it was over. And so the main thing that I want to leave you with and to ask you to consider is just your needs, if you're a patient or a caregiver, and the patient's and caregiver's needs if you're a provider, because you get to choose who you are in the story. You are going to be remembered in the story of the people who have gone through something horrific. And you know, Dr. Willie has had thousands of patients since then. And when I did a talk with him, we did a Schwartz Rounds where we presented in front of providers 8 years after Wesley died. He said, In all of my practice and all of my years practicing medicine since Wesley died, I have never made a decision thinking about the caregivers and the loved ones without thinking about Lisa and Wesley. Because you have to remember, Wesley was on a ventilator the whole time. He never got off. And he died 6 weeks after his transplant. That day, he was supposed to get into a cardiac chair and get out of bed for the first time. He didn't code this time. It wasn't anything. He'd overcome shingles. He'd overcome every code. At one point, he'd coded for 40 minutes. And he came back from it. And 2 days later, was sitting up eating ice chips. But Dr. Willie knew who Wesley was because I made sure of it. And he knew who Hunter was. And he will get a graduation announcement from our family because he helped us get that try. And he had as much empathy as anyone I've ever met. So I just encourage you to consider who you are in someone's story, consider who you are in your own story, and continue to sharpen your skills and muster whatever bravery you have, because sometimes confrontation is necessary. And no matter what happens to your loved one, to yourself, to your patient, everyone needs to leave it knowing that everyone did everything they could, that everyone tried. And I've lived all of these 17 years since Wesley died, knowing how hard we all tried, including the donor family, including Hunter at 5 years old, not knowing what in the world was going on, but knowing now at 22, how much we fought for him and for his dad and for our family. So that's all I have to share about that. And I just hope that by sharing our story, which isn't always easy to do, it just helps someone else along in there. As I always say it, I'm willing to lend our story if it helps someone else better live or tell their own. So that is it.